My name is Jenny Cunningham, and I'm going to be not so much chairing the discussion today as leading a conversation. And I'm going to have a conversation with our guest speakers for about 20 minutes or so. And then, hopefully, we are going to have a conversation with you for the rest of the time, taking your points of view. But people have an idea, an underlying worry, if you like, that things are happening in South Africa and perhaps not happening in a very positive direction. So hopefully today we will explore really what is happening in South Africa, what is positive and what is negative. So we have a very, very erudite but also experienced panel. These are people who are from South Africa, live in South Africa, or return to South Africa very regularly, so know the country very well. I'll start off with Lindsay Johns over here. He's a writer and broadcaster, writes, for example, for newspapers like the Cape Argus. He's also recently started a theatre trip initiative for quite a deprived township school on the Cape Flats. He is a non-residential fellow at Hutchins Center for African-American Research at Harvard University. After him is Sharmini Brookes. She is also a freelance writer and blogger based in Johannesburg. She writes a lot of reviews, actually, for a very, very interesting website called Artslink. And South Africa has a very vibrant cultural and art scene, and Sharmini writes for them. She also writes for the online spiked newspaper in this country. She comes from a family of people who've long been involved in the struggle against apartheid, many of whose members have landed up at one stage or another on Robben Island, so comes from a family who fought apartheid for many, many years. Matthew Kruger is a lawyer. He's a lecturer in jurisprudence at the University of the Witwatersrand in Johannesburg. He's currently doing a PhD in law at King's College in London. He was previously involved as a legal researcher in the Helen Suzman Foundation and has been involved in areas relating to political corruption, police independence, and state accountability. So a wide range of experiences of South Africa, some very immediate. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off the discussion, and then I'm going to ask our speakers if they would perhaps respond to a few of my questions, just to set the scene and hopefully raise some of the issues you might like to comment on or ask questions about. So my first question to the panel is really, why did the ruling ANC organization do so badly in the local elections in August? Their support fell below 60% for the first time, although they did secure 54% of the national vote in those local elections. And they lost control in four major metropolitan areas. So quite a significant setback for them. And I'm wondering why they really did so badly.
In answer to the question, I think the most obvious thing to say is because the ANC have time after time shown themselves to be endemically corrupt and morally unfit to govern, lacking the all-important moral compass. A valiant opposition party, but a very, very poor ruling party. All over Cape Town and the Western Cape, and that's the area of South Africa that I know particularly well, poor Africans and coloureds are fed up of Zuma's elite brazenly feathering their own nest. Building his own village with public funds was the final straw. Ordinary people, however loyal to the bygone days of the struggle mentality, are now finally seeing that Zuma et al. has presided over a nefarious kleptocracy. Sadly, this was probably inevitable that it would come to pass thus. Inevitable that human greed would trump human decency. In the latest elections, Zuma was thankfully humiliated. In Joburg, the ANC got only 44% of the vote, thereby losing its majority. The DA has ruled Cape Town, naturally by far South Africa's best city, for 10 years under Mayor Patricia de Lille. And I think that this time, in these elections, for the first time, people actually had a genuine alternative to the ANC. I think we'll explore that a bit later on. That's my opening salvo.
That's the Democratic Alliance, for those of you who don't know the acronyms. Sharmini, what's your thoughts on this?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with Lindsay about the corruption. I mean, it's in the news daily. There's loads of examples about the, you know, Zuma's house in Kandla was a long-running saga. But then, you know, the arms deal has always been in the background, continuing. The local government, the way in which funds for education, for schools, you know, resources are always going into the pockets of politically nominated councillors. You know, the resources always is. So all of that is true. But I think also another aspect to it was the way in which the ANC today seems to be, it's unable to fulfill the aspirations of what is a rising, younger, more educated, more urban, black middle class. They have got a big support amongst their rural community, but the rising young, urban, educated, more educated middle class sees no way of fulfilling their aspirations, and that maybe it'll come on a bit later when we talk about problems with the ANC's economic policy now. And so their appeals constantly over the years, they've always appealed to their past and their sense of themselves as this amazing liberation or movement, which again, I mean, people in the audience who know a lot more about those sort of periods. I think it's kind of rewriting history in some ways. They did not, the ANC was always one of these, you know, an organization that was geared towards political representation and was not an organization that was able to build mass support. It was really their links with the SACP that gave them that those radical credentials. What, you know, we can see that through the negotiated settlement, which was always their aim, they have achieved their goal, which was to get representation in government. And so their appeals to this past no longer, it doesn't attract the young people today, because you have people sitting after, you know, getting a university degree, sitting in back rooms in their parents' shacks with no job, nowhere to go, you know, and feeling completely resentful. So I think that's an important aspect of why they lost this election.
South African Communist Party, SACP.
I'm sorry.
I'll try avoid acronyms as I go through. Yeah, I agree with both Lindsay and Sharmini. It's always difficult when trying to answer a question, well, why did a political party perform so poorly in a particular election, to oversimplify. And, you know, of course, you know, issues of corruption are systemic and they capture the attention of the media and of the broader public that we constantly have in Kandla. There's issues with our, you know, state-owned enterprises. The Treasury has recently been under attack by various members of, you know, political supposedly political corruption-fighting units. The Hawks would... It's essentially like an FBI-type body. There's obviously, and I think importantly, as Sharmini's touched on, there's been a break with the past, a break with tradition. A lot of the ANC's success, I think, emerges out of this de facto authority that it has, the sense that it was the vehicle, even though I think Sharmini's right that somewhat rewrites history and situating the ANC as the party or the organization that was primarily responsible for the fight against apartheid. It played a significant role, but it has cultivated this image of being the only party, the cause of the downfall of apartheid. And with that break with tradition, I think that's had a significant effect on its success in the most recent elections, together with, I think, the emergence of new political parties like the Economic Freedom Fighters, or going forward, the EFF, and also the success of the Democratic Alliance in places like Cape Town. It's slowly starting to shed its image as a white liberal party. It has its first black leader in Musi Maimane, so it's making steady progress. But then I think something that we shouldn't forget, we should try to put this result in context and perspective. There's no guarantee that the sort of 54% which it obtained will be reflected in the national elections. The ANC's voters, its typical support base, tends to come out more at national election time than it does at local governmental. And in addition to that, there was a significantly lower turnout on the part of a traditional ANC supporters versus, say, Democratic Alliance supporters. The DA was particularly successful and efficient in mobilizing very, very high turnout amongst its traditional base. So what will be very interesting in 2019, the next national elections, is to see whether people will, as many people will stay at home, and whether the effect that that will have on the overall representation in Parliament.
Just to throw in a sort of an economic question at this point, because it is clear that the ANC-led government has been unable really to halt the sort of decline in the South African economy, and there's still extremely high unemployment, around about 40%, and very widespread poverty. In fact, the socioeconomic divide in South Africa is as entrenched as it ever was. If anything, it's got a little worse under the ANC government. So it's to try and understand it. Do you think it's just simply corruption and greed amongst the ruling elite, or are there other issues, do you feel?
I'm sure that corruption plays a large part. I'm also no economist, but I'm pretty sure that the profusion of educated white South Africans who left the country post-94 with all their savings and who now live in Putney in Earl's Court might have something to do with it, by which I mean obviously the brain drain. A lot of white people left, they got out as early as they could, and they took a lot of money, skills and knowledge with them when things changed. Because they'd prospered under apartheid and had the access, the all-important access to education, they took that knowledge with them. So I think that's part of it. I think another factor to consider is the very high, arguably way too high, immigration rates from sub-Saharan West and also Central Africa, especially into Joburg and Cape Town, which have played a large part in local unemployment. The proliferation of Nigerians, Somalians, Zimbabweans, Congolese, Sudanese, not to mention the ones that perhaps are slightly more visible, the Chinese, and then less visibly, the Russians. On various levels, they undercut the local Africans and the local colored community, and in so doing, cause dissent. So I think there are a couple of things to consider.
Well, I mean, some people see it as like there's a sort of schizophrenic aspect to the ANC because it's, or to the government, basically, because it's an alliance, you know, of the ANC and the trade unions, COSATU, which is the Congress of South African Trade Unions, and then you've got the SACP. And a lot of people see it as this sort of like, what's holding them back is this kind of split between people who want a redistributive strategy, which was something that they put forward when they first came to power to address the needs of the poor, and then when Thabo Mbeki came in, a move towards what people see as neoliberal sort of policies, and that this tension means that there's no sense of real direction within the government, and they keep being pulled, not a real strategy. They keep being pulled in one direction or the other. But I also think that overall, it's not just the ANC, I think it's all the political parties, there isn't a real sense or belief in an idea of growing the economy as well, you know. So there's no dynamism in any sort of sector. So they kind of seem to be influenced by the global concerns around environment, sustainability. So areas like that might, like say fracking or nuclear energy or other ways of developing things, is kind of stifled also by that kind of ideology, I think, which covers all the parties. The other aspect was the negotiated settlement, which at the time, I think white businessmen were very keen. They were the ones who proposed the whole black ethnic minority, BBE, what is called BBE, black economic empowerment strategy, because it was a way whereby they could buy in members of the ANC ruling elite with shares in big companies, but the ownership still remained largely in the hands of the white capitalist class, which it still does to a large extent. And now you have these individuals who are tied into this personal deal, this wealth, and it's very difficult for them to kind of give that up. There's a kind of a fight with these sort of state-owned industries now between some of those capitalists who bought into these shares, and you know, the value may have fallen, and they're no longer worth anything anymore. So they're now calling for nationalization, which is like a weird thing, and to try and regain their money, whereas the South African Communist Party and the trade unions are against nationalization because they don't want to see the money going to these individuals. So all of those kind of things, I think, are hindering any forward-thinking policy that's going to take the country forward.
It's important to locate, I think, the source of not so much economic decline, but more economic stagnation, I think, in a couple of external and internal structural problems that you find with the country. So you must bear in mind that most of this economic decline or stagnation you find taking place in the late 2000s with the end of the commodities boom. So South Africa has always been a country that's relied quite heavily on gold and diamonds. With the end of the commodities boom, that naturally has an effect on our GDP growth. Now, most countries, when these sorts of things happen, could, through certain structural reforms, direct effort into other industries, so be it manufacturing or services, you would try to grow the economy in that way. But those alternative routes, I think, have been hindered, yes, by a lack of dynamism, a lack of corruption, a kind of too much corruption, or any corruption is too much corruption, I suppose. A kind of schizophrenia when it comes to policy. What are we? Are we a liberal democratic country, as you see under Thabo Mbeki? You know, what they call neoliberal policies is essentially, in any other part of the world, would be understood as welfarist and social democratic. But anything that slightly resembles an appreciation of the market is characterized as neoliberal. And so there's a lack of coherent strategy when it comes to growing the economy. But we also find more structural obstacles. So, you know, sort of starting under the old nationalist government, under apartheid, there was a lack of investment in electricity supply, so industry can't properly develop. Industry is asked to limit its production so the country doesn't go into permanent blackout. Now, that's obviously going to have an effect on economic growth. We have problems with, I think, our labor legislation. It's quite restrictive, both when it comes to the capacity to dismiss or retrench. Striking, the right to strike, though quite obviously essential, is also particularly protective of strikers' rights. And for me to say that sounds like I'm a neoliberal, but that naturally has an effect on the capacity of industry to grow. But I think most importantly, and it touches on the issue of the brain drain. I don't see the brain drain as actually being as big a problem as it was once forecast to be. I see the problem as more internal. Our education system, and people use the word broken in a lot of situations, but it is genuinely broken. We, despite being one of the highest per GDP despite our GDP percentage contribution to education being one of the highest in the world, I mean, our education system is perhaps worst or second worst in the world. It's truly, truly broken. I have friends who work in NGOs that deal with these issues, so Equal Education or the Legal Resources Center, and they're in certain provinces with a handful of people, they're essentially running the education system. They're acting like they're having to work as a kind of shadow government in action. There's famous cases of where books are never delivered just because government just doesn't pay for them. There's cases where the suppliers offer the books for free because they're like, okay, fine, you're not going to pay us. We think education's important. Here are the books. Delivers the books. Books are found in a river nearby the school because they're just not delivered. And without that education, it's there's never going to be any progress. So corruption, yes. Lack of dynamism, yes. But we simply don't have an educated youth. And without that, there's no chance.
Is there a really credible opposition or alternative to the ANC? For example, could young people, and you've all mentioned young people, could they play the kind of role that they played in the 70s and 80s in the fight against apartheid?
So there's sort of two parts to that question. One is there a credible opposition? And I think we've slowly seen that, yes, they are credible. There are two essentially two options, either in the Democratic Alliance, which, despite being characterized as part of the right or neoliberal, is would probably, in my view, be characterized by like a Bernie Sanders type character. So like that's you can understand how extreme to the left our politics in South Africa is. And the alternative option is with the EFF. The EFF is it's self-characterized as a kind of a Marxist-Leninist revolutionary party. So you those are essentially the two options.
Economic freedom fighters.
So those are essentially the two options on the table. It's very interesting to see what will happen in the next 3 years, whether the DA can continue to cultivate an image of being a party that will represent all people rather than a white neoliberal party. The EFF, I think its success turns a lot on whether it becomes something other than Julius Malema, who's an ex-ANC youth leader who said he would kill for Zuma. But then was kicked out and then is trying to destroy Zuma. Whether it can mature in the next 3 years. And as for the role of the youth, I think that it's tempting to draw comparisons with 1976 with the Soweto uprising, where high school students, marched on the streets in opposition to the education system. And naturally, that seen students shot and murdered, but provided a significant symbol, a rallying point around which people could gather. I'm not so sure you can draw, and we could probably address this more in the next, the fourth topic you want to address. I'm not so sure that the current student movements are equivalent to that. I'm not sure that they have the same support as that student movement did, but perhaps we can discuss that later.
Mm-hmm. I actually don't believe that there is a credible alternative at the moment to the ANC. I mean, the way I saw the current elections wasn't in as positive a way as some people here are seeing it. To me, it was really much more of an anti-ANC sentiment, which is why the turnout was so low, because people were completely disaffected from the political process. Most people really didn't want to vote. It sort of reminds me a little bit more of what's happening in America, that it's like, there's not really a choice to make. So the low turnout meant the ANC actually suffered. But the sense in which like the younger people who did vote were more like trying to vote as a protest, in that sense, rather than a real belief in DA politics. In fact, most commentators around the elections, when they were looking at, because most of them were hung parliaments, because they were, it was so marginal, the win over one or the other. and the EFF was sort of playing this kind of kingmaker. But most people were kind of arguing, actually, which I kind of believe, that there was much more in common between the DA and the ANC in terms of their policies, like being, you know, both of them are pretty pro-market, and you know, many of those policies, than there was between either of them with the EFF, right? The other thing with the EFF that people seem to, it's kind of weird. They might, they do sound sort of like very radical with their sort of land grabs and nationalization. And what people don't realize is that behind them, backing them, are these very rich black capitalists, you know, like Togo Seswale and all those sort of people. And as I said before, one of the reasons that they're pushing the nationalization thing is that, you know, they're going to make money, they can get rid of their losing shares in these mining companies and make a big killing through nationalization. So I wouldn't take that thing that, you know, the EFF is this amazing sort of, you know, well, not amazing, but, you know, very radical party that seriously. But anyway, even their talk about that means they don't have broad appeal. They have got some appeal to disaffected voters, and it's been fun in Parliament to see them putting Zuma under stress, you know, because it's not like the DA has, really. I mean, the EFF has, obviously, and people have enjoyed watching the ANC being put under, you know, making them feel, look a bit uneasy. But I don't really think that that's an alternative, and I think that's what we're struggling with at the moment, is trying to think what an alternative might be.
Yeah. Okay, in terms of a credible opposition, sadly not yet, but almost. I reckon it will take another 5 to 10 years. The DA leader, Muzi, is young and charismatic, but unfortunately he's struggling against the all too predictable, very toxic ANC accusation that he's the black face of a white party. As for Julius Malema, the radical, rabble-rousing demagogue who favours inflammatory, impassioned rhetoric on class and race over cool, logical analysis. Opinions are divided, although I actually think his audacious grandstanding has, I concede, been very successful in puncturing the aura of respectability around Zuma and in pricking and thus thankfully deflating Zuma's massive ego and the aura of invincibility. So what is the future? Potentially a DA-EFF coalition? That could well be on the cards. In terms of going forwards, and I think this would be my main point, I genuinely believe that South Africa is in need of new heroes with alacrity. And I'm talking about men who've walked with gods, but who then returned to earth to come and lead us. Mandela's gone, Sisulu's gone, Tambo's gone, Alex Laguma, the 60s and 70s Cape Townian novelist and freedom fighter, one of my own particular heroes, he's gone. Where are the great men with intellect, acuity of vision, perspicacity, moral compass, charisma, who are actually going to stand up and lead the fight for the next generation? Mm. Not being funny, but I don't think Trevor Manuel is a gymnast of the intellect, as much as he comes from Kensington. Another thing, in terms of the youth, the paradigms of the struggle have massively changed. In the 70s and 80s, it was a very, very clear Manichaean polarity. Good versus evil. We could all get that. It was very, very clear cut. Nowadays, things are a lot more nebulous, a lot more complicated. And I don't think there is such a clear cut division between good and evil. And just to throw in a little theatrical metaphor, obviously, I'm sure we're all big fans of Athol Fugard, The Islands, Sizwe Banzi is Dead, some fantastic plays. But can you name me a great play that Fugard's written post-apartheid? Didn't think so. I think that Fugard used apartheid, understandably so, as a creative muse. And in the same way, young people nowadays are lacking the stuff that they have to kick back against. So in answer to that, I think I don't think it's going to be the same for the young people.
Okay. Well, I would like to mention Thuli Madasela, who was the public protector, who actually has done more than anyone in the country to puncture Zuma, just in the sense that she was the one who actually nailed him on the expenses for, you know, using public money for expenses. It's just to really suggest that there might still be some women. I hope. Okay. I'll tell you what, I had a last question for the speakers, and I would ask you to just make one point each because we are running short of time. And that was, I think most people reading about South Africa here would be very, very well aware of the student angle in South Africa at the moment, with the, you know, students going on the rampage since about February time, and particularly around this idea of, you know, burning, you know, paintings of white people, and obviously the most famous, you know, bringing down the statue of the, you know, colonialist Cecil Rhodes. But going much further than that, you may be aware that they're making demands that the curriculum is more reflective of black interests and black policies, get rid of the white male canon, and also free, you know, free university tuition. So if you wouldn't mind a sort of fairly quick comment on these sort of things, Sharmini, we'll...
You know, what it is, I mean, for the first time, obviously, there's a large section of young black people who are now in the same arena as, you know, white, privileged, previously privileged communities. And so they're experiencing what it's like to sort of, you know, be comfortable and not, because most of these, although they're called middle class because they've been through maybe the private, what were formerly white schools, which are now Model C schools, so they're better schools, a lot of them, rather than the state schools, which are absolutely abysmal. But a lot of these people would have gone to the formerly white schools, which are better, and you know, hanging about with them at the universities, very privileged universities. Their backgrounds, I mean, what they see is nothing's changed at home. You know, most of them, their parents are still living in the township in pretty bad situation. A lot of them have to travel long distances to school. You know, so there's a lot of resentment that's sort of building up. And again, it's linked to the fact that, you know, there is this lack of growth. There's no sense that they're going to be able to better their positions, even with a university degree. So I think, you know, that's partly one of the reasons why it's taken that kind of racial form as well, you know, because it's a fighting for diminishing resources. And you know, they can see that the people they now with, you know, have some, and they can't get there.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks very much.
I'd actually like to try and look at the question from the other perspective. The question is, why are student protests so racially motivated? Well, I'd actually like to ask, why aren't they? Protests in South Africa, at least for the foreseeable future, in my opinion, will always be racially motivated. Why wouldn't they be? It would actually be strange if they weren't. South Africa today is still a heinously unequal, racially segregated society. Cape Town is probably one of the most racially segregated cities in the world due to the pernicious apartheid legacy. You've got incredibly opulent, former white areas like Constantia, Camps Bay, Bishop's Court, existing 15-minute drive from the insalubrious townships of coloured and African shanty shacks. So there's de facto economic and effectively racial segregation. The African and coloured students have some legitimate grievances, although I personally don't think that road should fall. In my opinion, I think they're going about it the wrong way. If we look at America, the ramifications of slavery are still sadly being felt some 150 years post-emancipation. Why should we then think that in 20 years South Africa will overcome its own tortured racial legacy? Very, very quickly, in terms of decolonizing the canon, or decolonizing the curriculum, I think in a nutshell, it's very, very misguided, it's very myopic, and it's madness. Because it actually denies us our own common humanity. Where's it going to end? Are we going to say that we can't study Isaac Newton in science because he's a dead white guy? It's madness. I don't go to Dickens because he's a dead white guy. I go to him because he's a timeless, universal storyteller. I don't think we need to tear down the statue of Rhodes. That's history. We can't change history. But let's put up a statue to Alex Laguma or Nelson Mandela or all of the other great freedom fighters. Just to finish on one little quotation, there's a fantastic African-American scholar called Dr. Molefi Asante, and he said, in terms of the canon and what we do with it, it's not enough to know. Let's act to humanize the world. If we spent more time not quibbling about what's been put in the canon, but actually going out imbibing from the canon the beauty, the goodness, and trying to the love, and trying to put that into practice, then maybe South Africa would be in a better place.
Yeah, I think there's always a danger when talking about these sorts of issues to speak in monolithic or homogenous terms. There is no the students. There are multiple groups of individuals who all have different interests, who are motivated for different reasons, who have different ideologies, who are converging, who are characterized by the media and by people like us as the students, and that allows you to talk about student leaders. It allows you to talk about the, what do the students think, what do the students want. But there's such diversity and conflict within the youth, that we need to be careful about whom we're talking about. And everyone knows a lot about Rhodes Must Fall. But Rhodes Must Fall is an exceptionally small group of people. We're talking about dozens of people who are extremely influential. So I've been struggling with how to talk about RMF for a long time. RMF leaders, but I don't think they're leaders. I think at best they're influential voices that are given a lot of airtime. So to when we talk about decolonization, that idea has its roots in the New Left, emerging from Europe and emerging from America. They're deeply influenced by people like Fanon and Césaire and Kimberly Crenshaw and Derek Bell, all ironically talking about decolonization, but drawing the ideas from deeply Western, very Western countries. So when we're talking about these groups of students, we need to be careful about who we're referring to. Is it RMF? Is it Fees Must Fall? Is it the people who, at my university, my undergrad, UK, in Durban, that have been protesting about poverty and housing and fees for well over a decade, but were never listened to? None of this is really new. It's really how the narrative we're now constructing around it, and this mistaken effort to try unify or conceive of the students as a single block.
Useful point. Thank you very much. Now, our panel has gone on a little longer than I'd hoped, but if we could take a round of questions and points.
It's a very interesting discussion. I'm just picking up on the last discussion, really, because a lot of the debates that I've been to at the Battle of Ideas have been about identity politics, and they seem to have a kind of a real global character to them. So I'm quite curious to what extent what's happening in South Africa is influenced by global trends towards identity politics and towards the fragmenting actions of those ideas, where people just sort of set themselves up in smaller and smaller groups. And you've talked about the racial element to some extent, but so I can see that would be a very strong element. But there are obviously many other elements of identity politics, sort of, the LGBT and all of the feminism and all of that. And I'm just wondering whether that kind of penetrates into South Africa, or whether the racial element is still the strongest, or whether it gets expressed in a different kind of way.
It's kind of related to that. I read a really fascinating piece by a former vice-chancellor at Cape Town University, Njambulo Ndumbele, that's his name. And he's the article sort of reflecting on Steve Biko and what was then and what's sort of happening now. And he says, he's noting that there has been obviously the collapse of white apartheid power, and yet there's still this recurring race. And what he seems to be suggesting is that, which goes kind of speaks to what you were saying, Lindsay, in a questioning way, which is that race is no longer that kind of political category. But instead, he's quite concerned about the way it comes to be seen as the prism through which all experience is understood. So he talks about a killing that happened recently, a horrible, brutal killing of a black man tortured and dragged, behind a pickup truck. And he asks the question, you know, if you see that as a racist crime, then you're dehumanizing that person because you're cutting him off from his humanity. You're seeing him as a data for a political discourse that doesn't actually really exist of racism, rather than understanding it as a horrific crime against humanity. And I just wondered if you thought that was happening.
My question concerns the International Criminal Court and the proposal, or was it a decision, of South Africa to withdraw from the International Criminal Court, and how significant is that, even as a position that may or may not happen? How significant is that?
It seems as though there's kind of been a kind of a cross-pollination going on between university protests in South Africa and here. So Rhodes must fall started, it seems, in the University of Cape Town, was picked up in Oxford, and it seems as though it's been replayed back in the universities now. The mixture of protests that I take what you say, Matthew, advisedly, that I don't want to group everyone all together, but I'm just wondering about the dynamic of this cross-pollination. Is it, because now recently we've had this Science Must Fall demands, so is this opening up a schism in these sort of protest movements, and to what extent can we read this as part of what's happening, as Wendy says, you know, in universities globally?
I'll speak to the question of the International Criminal Court first. Now, obviously, that represents a significant setback in, from an international perspective, and generating a global support for what I think is a very important institution, albeit one that has problems, democratic problems. There are issues regarding its prosecutorial history. So there are issues there. And I think our withdrawal as one of the major players in Africa from it might open the floodgates, and that's deeply unfortunate, I think. But from the perspective of South Africa's obligations to pursue these sorts of individuals, when I was working for the Helen Suzman Foundation, we went to the Supreme Court of Appeal as in the Al Bashir litigation, and one of our arguments was essentially that even if we're not a member of this sort of body, we have a constitutional obligation that founded within the text of the Constitution itself to pursue these sorts of individuals. Now, that wasn't the line the court took, because it didn't need to, ultimately, in the end. But I still think that even if we do withdraw, and it looks like we're going to withdraw, that won't affect our domestic obligations to arrest people like this when, you know, genocidaires, war criminals, people responsible for the rape and murder of 300,000 people, to arrest these and prosecute these sorts of people when they step on our shore.
Partly, I mean, there is something historical with this in the sense that, you know, I mean, it is surprising, given that we're supposed to have gotten rid of apartheid, that the new society seems to be so much more so racialized still. And, you know, there is something to say that, you know, there was the opportunity to sort of not look at things through a racial category, and that was lost, actually, because within the ANC constitution was the enshrinement of recognition of minority rights by race, and I think that was part of the compromise that was there, because it was a way of protecting the white minority rights to a large extent as well. But, you know, the ANC played to that, and then now everything, you know, so you've got all the discussions about quotas and the BEE thing and so on. So everything, in fact, race is sort of more important now in some ways, you know, to define who you are by racial category. So I think that's why it's kind of like still there. And then there doesn't seem to be a common cause around which people can unite against the government. I mean, you can, you know, see that in the students. You know, they're actually fighting against the universities who can't really change the situation. They're not really challenging the government, and whether that's, you know, the fact that it is a black government. And in the past, students were united against apartheid, so it was very clear what you were challenging. And I don't think that clarity is there now, what it is that they really trying to fight against. It's been confused by the fact that this is the movement that was supposed to have brought freedom, but at the same time they haven't. Expectations were raised and they haven't. So it's very different to some of the past protests.
I think that identity politics has been around for a long time. So, for example, from the 50s, 60s, you've got Cape Tony authors like Alex Leguma, Richard Reeve, you've got Dennis Brutus discussing notions of coloured identity. In the 80s, you had Alan Bosack very prominently on the world stage. But I think increasingly, under apartheid, just as a personal opinion, I think that Africans and colours were much more united under apartheid. I often use the example of that wonderful film Independence Day with Will Smith, which came out in 1996, when common humanity is united against the aliens. There's a common enemy there. Okay, whereas nowadays, I think, post-apartheid, one little example which was very telling, when Wade van Niekerk won the Olympic Rio 400 metres, that wonderful race, Cape Town, especially the Western Cape, also South Africa, exploded in a proliferation of comment pieces discussing coloured identity. Was Wade, was it a victory for black South Africans? Was it a victory for coloured South Africans? And there is an argument to be made that with the increasing marginalisation of the coloured community in South Africa, identity politics does have to come to the fore to represent. Another point to pick up about the LGBT representation. I abhor homophobia and I've always been very proud of the fact that Cape Town, I think, has got a reputation as one of the most gay-friendly cities in Africa. The very word Mofi, there's a very, very strong Mofi tradition, especially amongst coloured culture, but I'm sure in other traditions as well. So hopefully that can continue.
We often talk about identity politics, and there's often, I think, a lack of clarity about what we mean. Now, I think there is a difference between the sort of tradition that you're talking about, Nancy, the recognition of the significance of race or class or gender or sex to one's experiences and how that goes to constitute one's identity. That's been around for a long time, absolutely. But I think what we're seeing now is different. Its ideological underpinnings are different. The identity politics that we're seeing emerging within certain groups like RMF come directly out of a particular school of thought. It comes out of writers, be they critical, the critical schools, be they critical race theorists, be they, it's largely speaking, the New Left. And these are the sorts of ideas which conceive of our humanity as fundamentally limited by and determined by our past experiences. Now, we focus on race, yes, naturally and understandably, and yeah, I think rightly, obviously. But what we're seeing within these sorts of groups is the shutting out and refusal to discuss with people who are not exactly like you. You don't know my lived experience. Therefore, how can you know my lived reality? You must accept my lived truths. And what that prevents or what that precludes is the capacity for genuine intersubjective dialogue, the capacity to somehow transcend our given station through imagination and empathy and then arrive at some kind of human universal. There's a rejection entirely of universals. There's this deeply Foucauldian idea of truth as power. And truth is simply deeply contingent, and it's on whatever experience you happen to have. And that's different from the recognition of the importance of one's experience as a coloured man or a lesbian woman. So we need to distinguish between, say, race consciousness and racial identity politics. I think you have to be conscious in this way of someone's racial experiences, but that's not to say that that's determinative of their ideas and their views.
Very good point.
I'd like to make a point that relates more to the earlier part of this discussion, which was about the question of why did the ANC do so badly in the recent elections. Perhaps a more interesting question would be, why has it taken so long for the ANC to do badly in elections? And I think the answer really is not about failure of delivery of services, which is clear and appalling, but not new. Corruption, appalling and getting worse, but not new. I think what is new is the fact that the ANC are operating in a new world politically, which they have no longer purchase of. And the two things that were absolutely key to the ANC's political hegemony when they came in and, you know, to power was, number one, fantastic political legitimacy, given that they dominated the anti-apartheid struggle and consolidated their position internationally, especially through Mandela. So fantastic political legitimacy. And second, in the very process by which they came to power, the success with which they integrated themselves with the South African white business establishment meant that they had a tremendous degree of insulation from mass pressure. They were in a little, very comfortable bubble that need not, their Minister of Housing did not have to sweat all night worrying about the delivery of houses and so on, because there was that political pressure was something that they were insulated from. Those two things have now gone. One reason being that political loyalty is gone, because those who have the experience of apartheid oppression are now in their 40s and 50s, so that's a chronological reason for it. But also the deep-rooted political affinities have eroded. And the generation that is coming up about now doesn't hold these loyalties anymore. So they're in a completely new in a political environment which they have no longer any purchase of. And I just would like to throw out a more recent question, though. The issue of corruption is growing and is coming now to coming to a head, I think, with the challenge, Jenny, you mentioned, Thuli Madonsela. This is a question, really, about where is the political will to uphold the South African constitution, and where is the depth of politics in South Africa that's going to defeat Zuma? It's a much broader question than corruption, but it leads to very specific corrupt issues like South African Airways, the purchase of 9 nuclear power stations, all the rest of this. Where is Parliament and where is the political will to hold South Africa's leaders to account?
I'm coming at this from a position of being interested in academic freedom, and I thought Matthew's statement just now about critical race theory and making a differentiation between that and understanding race in a different way and the importance of race in society was just absolutely brilliant. That was a really great and useful statement. Because, you know, as an academic, I come up against the critical race theory a lot, and it does tend to be quite censorious, and you know, have to kind of argue the point to speak freely on campus. Now, on the other hand, the students themselves are they should have free expression, and you know, it's a healthy thing that students are rebelling and protesting. But I just wonder why they have so much influence in the public debate. So, you know, the Rhodes Must Fall discussion at Oxford, as well as in South Africa, is known globally. We all know about it. You know, it's part of our public discussion. And so, I'm just wondering why people are so interested in what's going on on campuses. As an academic, I'm interested, you know, in academic freedom and free speech, but with some fellow academics, I wrote a letter to the Telegraph just last year, just before Christmas, about academic freedom, and it became a piece on the full front page spread about academic freedom, just from our letter, you know, and I was a little bit kind of taken aback by this. This was a letter. So why is it in South Africa and here that in subjects which are of interest to students and they're kind of, you know, playing with different ideas and trying to experiment with things, which do have this censorious edge, why has it become such a big social and political question? You know, why does it go into society more broadly?
Just like to put this question to the panel. Post-Mandela, and especially addressing Lindsay over there, if I may, can you see a figure emerging which can unite the South African people, iconic or not iconic? And if that figure does emerge, will they be bumped off or murdered?
I'm going to ask our guest speakers if they would either take up any of those questions, but in a space of a minute and a half.
I think it's going to be Trevor Noah, equal opportunities offender, okay? Looks coloured, German-Swiss dad, African mum. I think that's going to be the future of South Africa, right? A podgycross of all humanity. And hopefully with his trenchant, no cow is too sacred approach, ideally that's the way we can go forwards. Just as a general wrap-up, I think it's very easy to be pessimistic about post-apartheid South Africa. I think there are lots and lots of problems. But when you go onto the Cape Flats or some of the townships in outside Joburg, for example, you actually see the little kids dressed in their really, really smart school uniforms. They've got that thirst for learning. They've got that thirst. They've got absolutely nothing. And they've been defecated on from a great height by all and sundry over many, many, many years. I mean, just look at the experience on the Cape Flats. They've just been dumped there after the forced removals in the 60s and 70s. And yet there is a gleam of hope. And we have to emphasize the hope. We can't just be continuing with the naysayers. We've got to put it right, and we've got to big up the hope for the next generation.
Yeah, and Cheryl's question about why it's, you know, all taking place in the universities, and you know that's the area where all these protests and resentments are coming out. I mean, I think, you know, we can see a big difference between the way the government responded to, say, workers coming out on protests like Marikana or even some of the service delivery protests. I mean, they didn't hesitate to just send in, you know, the police and just shoot them down. There's a very different response to, like, how they deal with, the, with how they're dealing with the students. And, you know, part of it is sort of like, you know, like a child having a tantrum, and there's all these adults standing around, like not knowing, not saying anything, you know. So, I mean, it is the area where I suppose people pay lip service in some ways to academic freedom, and then you also look to your elites, you know, they are the elites in those institutions to stand up for certain values. And it doesn't seem that there is anybody there who's challenging any of the ideas that the students are putting forward, so they can speak rubbish about Fanon and all these people and make these claims about decolonized education. And most of the lecturers and so on almost feel too guilty to challenge that outlook, or actually some of them actually agree with it, which is the worst thing, you know. And then you've got a situation where even amongst the establishment, they're all pointing the finger at each other, the finger of blame. So it's just like a green light to these students to just carry on. And initially, when they first went on the protest, even I was like a bit initially, thought, oh, great, you know, somebody's at least putting the government under some pressure, because before that, there'd been all these service delivery protests, which the government just like ignored, you know. They were, as Barry was saying, completely aloof initially from those kind of things. And but, I mean, you know, I think, as I say, it was more to do with the fact that nobody was prepared to stand up to the students, so they had more scope to, just go on. And now what you see is amongst themselves, they're fragmenting because there is no sense of leadership or common cause. You know, they're fragmenting around identities, political. Nobody wants to take leadership, in fact. That's why there's no negotiations happening, because even amongst the students, nobody wants to take the responsibility to actually come to some agreement and put and argue for that idea with the rest of the students. You know, so they're saying, oh, the chancellors must come and meet us in a stadium and speak to all the students. So there's no leadership there. So there's no, doesn't seem to be any sense of resolution to that situation.
Yeah, just to take up that point a little bit further, I think we can probably locate this almost fixation on the students in a number of sources. One, I do think there's far too many academics actually peddle these ideas. I think the academic establishment is littered with gender studies, race studies, media studies, critical studies, and the ideas are not coming out of nowhere. The students have embraced these ideas because they've been taught them for 30, 40, 50 years. This is simply the culmination of that. RMF is the culmination of what the students have been taught. So I think there's deep sympathy on the part of the academics. I think that has led to some of the deeply weak responses on the part of certain universities, and I'm thinking particularly on the part of UCT and the way that they've dealt with this. And that's an important distinction I think we can draw between someone like Max Price and Adam Habib, the Vice Chancellor of UCT and WITS. They've now started to approach these issues in different ways because I think they have different ideological sympathies. I think also the media, which is still in South Africa, is very, very, very small and also is deeply sympathetic with a lot of these ideas. The common pieces proliferate with language about how outsourcing of labor is violent in the same way that rape is violent. It's like it's just nonsense, but it's perfectly consistent if you hold these new left ideas. And I think insofar as how it's gained significant public support, that emerges out of what I spoke about earlier, this conflation of all these different movements. The majority of people do see students marching and say, yes, there's genuine injustice that inspires this. There's poverty and racism and homophobia, significant inequality, and yes, we support that. But then they fail to make the distinction between student leaders or influential voices and these people who have been protesting and marching for well over a decade. So we need to understand the ideological roots of some of these protests, and we need to draw a distinction between motivation and justification.